Today's topic is about thrust to weight ratio and wing loading. In aircraft design, this thrust to weight ratio and wing loading are the two most important parameters affecting the aircraft performance. Okay, they are the two, that is TW and WS are the two important parameters which is affecting the aircraft performance. Okay, so the optimization of these parameters forms and major part of the analytical design activities and conducted after an initial design layout. Okay, the methods used to optimizations are, you can look here, the one is thrust to weight ratio is made for the initial design layout in begun. That is, so when you look here, for example, wing loading used for initial layout is a very low, implying the large wing, the designer will have no trouble finding the room for the landing gear and the fuel tanks. It means that if larger the wings, what it is there, we can, the fuel we can store in a larger amount, and also we can have a good landing gear home for the landing gear also, it's not a problem. But if you are making up a compact the wing, what happens at the time, the wing loading will be higher when you compare with a smaller area, because like area, that is distribution per unit area, will be larger. At that time, it's very difficult to for the fuel, for the home for the fuel as well as the landing gear. So therefore, the wing loading plays a very important role in the performance of the aircraft. And wing is the main, the lifting surface, where it will be range, endurance, rate of turn. These are all of the performance parameters of the aircraft. So while they could put in the fuselage, this could increase the wetted area and therefore the drag. What happens if you are larger the wing? What happens? The wetted area. What is this wetted area? Wetted area is nothing but a what? The wing which is exposed to air. Means the part of the wing which is exposing to the air is referred as wetted area. Is referred as what? The wetted area. And therefore the drag. So the optimization results would probably be no good. And wing loading, thrust to weight ratio are interconnected in a number of performance calculations such as takeoff distance, which is frequently critical design driver. So thrust to weight ratio and are interconnected. Here wing loading and thrust to ratio are interconnected. W by S and D by W are interconnected. We can look here, W by S and T by W. Both are the weight factors. Okay, so you can look here, a requirement for short takeoff met by using large wing, that is low W by S with a relatively small engine. It means that larger the wing area, what happens, there will be a, we can look here, so wing loading will be less with relatively small engine, low T by W. So it means that, so if you having an engine is less, so engine, we have a smaller engine, thrust will be less, and with respect to the weight, and also wing loading, if you are larger the wing loading will be less. So therefore, if larger the wing and smaller the engine, so what happens here, low the wing loading and lower the T by W, both are interconnected. So before, we can look here, the relation between the W by S and T by W plays a very important role. We have to understand that concept here. So while the small engine will cause the aircraft to accelerate slowly, it only needs to reach the moderate speed to lift off the ground. Means whenever you want to take off, the thrust to weight ratio, because smaller engine, how much thrust is producing? So to leave the ground, so to take off, understood. On the other hand, the same takeoff distance could be met with a small wing, that is a high wing loading, because smaller the wing, the loading will be higher, because when it is reduces the area, what happens? The force per unit area will be higher. So therefore, higher the wing loading, provided that the larger the engine, so high thrust to weight ratio. It means that with the load is higher, so therefore capability to uplift that, there is propulsion is required, that is a larger engine. So therefore, high wing loading, high T by W, means lower the W by S, lower the T by W, higher the wing loading, higher the T by W. So it means that W by S and T by W are directly proportional. Understood. In this case, aircraft must reach the high speed to lift off, but the larger engine can rapidly accelerate the aircraft to that speed. Due to this interconnection, it is frequently difficult to use historical data to independently selected initial values for wing loading and thrust to weight ratio. So therefore, here instead, the designer must guess at one of the parameter and use that guess to calculate the other parameters from the critical design requirements. Clear? Here we look here. This is called thrust to weight ratio. When you look here, so already we discussed that lower the wing loading, lower the T by W. Higher the wing loading, higher the T by W. It means that lower the wing loading is nothing but a what? Larger the wing. Where the T by W is lower, where the small engines. So these are all, they are both are interconnected. We have to understand. Clear? They are directly proportional. So in this, when you are going to, like particularly when I speak about thrust to weight definitions. A TYW directly affects the performance of the aircraft. It directly affecting the performance of the aircraft. And aircraft with a higher TYW will accelerate more quickly. It means higher TYW is nothing but a what? Engine power would be more. So therefore, thrust generation will be more and lesser the wing loading. So more rapidly reach the higher maximum speed and sustain the high turn rates. Other than that, larger engines will consume more fuel throughout the mission, which will drive up the aircraft's takeoff gross weight to perform the design mission. It means that what is happening? These are the performance parameters. What is that? Climb rate, range, endurance, understood, rate of climb. These are all are the performance parameters of the aircraft. What are this? Climb, range of the aircraft, endurance of the aircraft, rate of turn. These are all are the parameters of the, they are called performance parameters of the aircraft. So TYW is not constant because TYW will not be constant. Why? Because weight is reducing as the mission proceeds. It means that the fuel consumption, whatever the fuel you stored in the aircraft will be, yeah, when it is takeoff, it is just, it will be reducing as the mission takeoff, climb, and it will be cruise. At every mission leg, there will be a consumption of the fuel. Clear? So the weight of the aircraft varies during the flight as fuel is burned. Also, the engine thrust varies with altitude and velocity. When designers speak of an aircraft thrust to weight ratio, they generally refer to the TYW during the sea level static, that is called zero velocity, standard day conditions at design takeoff weight and maximum throttle setting. Another commonly referred to is TYW concerns about combat conditions. The combat conditions mainly in the military aircrafts, clear? Yes, you can calculate TYW at partial power setting. For example, during the approach landing, throttle setting is nearly idle. So the operating TYW at that point in the mission is probably around 0.05, clear? And it's very important to avoid confusing between TYW with the TW at other conditions in the calculations below. If a required TYW is required at some other conditions, it must be adjusted back to the takeoff conditions for using the selecting the number of size of engines. It means that during the takeoff, how much it is, the thrust to weight ratio. The mainly we are considering during the takeoff, and according to that, we are taking into considerations how many engines are required during the takeoff conditions. Clear? So these TYW adjustment will be done later. We'll see about it. And also, here what happens, there will be a power loading or a horsepower to weight ratio. It's mainly TYW, it is for jet based aircraft. For power loading, it is for propeller based aircrafts. The thrust to weight ratio is associated with jet engine aircraft. Please, you have to make the note of it here. Mainly TYW, when I speak, I'm speaking about jet engined aircraft. If I speak about propeller powered aircraft, it will be around W/HP, that is wing loading. It is called power loading, we will call it. W/HP is nothing but a what? Power loading. It's called power loading. Power loading as an opposite connotation from TYW. So therefore, power loading and horse to weight. So therefore, the term thrust to weight ratio mainly used for jet engine aircrafts and W/HP for power loading. So therefore, TYW is not a constant. The weight of the aircraft varies during the flight as fuel is burned and engines thrust. And you can look here. So we can look here. You can look here. So HP/W, this is called power loading as an opposite connotation of TYW, that is W/HP we will take, that is called power loading we will take, which is called as a horsepower, that's called power loading, W/HP. This is mainly used for, it's mainly used for propeller based aircraft. Clear? Power loading as an opposite connotation from form of TYW. And also we look here, a propeller powered aircraft, and also you can see here, this is eta P, it is called as a propeller efficiency we will call. The weight of the aircraft varies during the flight as fuel is burned. The engine's thrust varies with altitude and velocity. And this in the propeller-based aircraft, it is called eta P. The eta P is nothing but a what? Propeller efficiency. This is called eta P is defined as the thrust output per horsepower provided by that. So therefore, it is called the propeller efficiency. We'll call it. It's called what? Propeller efficiency. We can look here and you can see TYW. It is TYW. So TYW, we can see 550 eta P/V and HP/W. This is called power loading, HP/W for propeller-based aircraft. And 550 eta P, eta P is nothing but a what? It is called as a propeller efficiency and V is the velocity. And also to avoid excessive verbiage discussion below, the term thrust to weight ratio should be understood to include the horsepower to weight ratio for propeller aircraft. Means TYW, when you are speaking about it, for propeller based aircraft, you have to include, this is called HP/W, that is called power loading. Please, you have to include for mainly for propeller based aircraft. Clear? and statistical for a jet trainer, you can see here. So we can, these are all the things what you need to be understood. You can look here. And you have jet trainer, it will be typical installed TBW is 0.4, jet fighter will be 0.9, jet fighter other will be 0.6, military cargo bomber will be 0.25, and jet transport will be 0.25. Understood. So therefore, horse power to weight ratio, mainly when you see W by HP and HP by W, that's a power loading and power, it's called power loading, that is a horse power to weight ratio. And you can 25 for power sail, home built for 12, 14. It depends upon the different type of aircrafts. You can look here. So this is for mainly jet aircraft, but TYW will speak. And I'm speaking about a propeller based aircraft. I'm speaking about a power loading. Yeah. So we have to include power loading also. Yeah. And you can look here. See here, note that current generation of dogfighters approaches mainly TYW is equal to 1. That ratio should be is equal to 1, implying that thrust is nearly equal to the weight. It means that TYW is equal to 1. If I put T is equal to W, T is equal to W is nothing but what? Thrust is equal to weight. Thrust is equal to weight. Clear? And you can see here, in this thrust matching, it's also a very important one, the thrust matching when you are understanding. For aircraft designed primarily for efficiency during the cruise, better initial estimate, TYW can be obtained by thrust matching. It is nothing but a thrust matching is nothing but a what? This refers to the comparison of selected engine thrust available during the cruise to the estimated aircraft drag. Means we are thrust to the drag. We are going to match it. That is called thrust matching, we will call it. It's called what? Thrust matching. You can see TYW cruise divided by L by D cruise. It is the lift to drag ratio. It is nothing but a what? It is lift to drag ratio. It is called aerodynamic efficiency. So therefore, according to that, during the thrust to weight ratio, during the cruise, and it is the inverse of L by D cruise, by that we are going to do the thrust matching. Clear? L by D can be estimated in a variety of ways, and T by W is the method for L by D estimation. And also you can see here, mainly for jet aircrafts, L by D is 86.6, that is called 0.866 the cruise, and we have a L by D, and we, you know that the loiter for the cruise is understood. It is a it is for range for the aircraft. It is like a, they are vice versa. The propeller and jet aircrafts will be vice versa. That is for loiter for the cruise is range for the propeller. Range for the propeller. And we have when the wing loading has been selected, and you can look here. We can discuss about it, and you can look here. And see here, like a D by W naught, it is W naught is nothing but the total design gross weight, and M is the maximum mark. And we have, you can look here, the thrust during the cruise of the different from the takeoff value, and just a jet aircraft are normally designed to cruise approximately the altitude at which the selected engine was the best specific fuel consumption. That is typically around 32,000 or 40,000 feet when you are flying, when the aircraft is flying it at 30,000 to 40,000 feet. It is the one of the mainly it is. It's a feasible range of flying altitude, and you have to understand about it. The cruise thrust has altitude, therefore the less than the maximum takeoff thrust sea level. So the required cruise T by W must be adjusted to obtain the equivalent takeoff of T by W. Okay, and typically the subsonic high bypass ratio turbofans. So these high bypass ratio turbofans mainly they use for a subsonic based aircraft, and low bypass ratio will be used for the supersonic aircrafts. Yeah. And you can look here, T by W takeoff is equal to T by W cruise by W takeoff, and T takeoff by T cruise. It means that thrust to weight ratio of the cruise and W cruise, weight at the cruise and weight at the takeoff, and thrust at the takeoff towards the thrust at the cruise. This gives complete T by W at the cruise. You can look at pressure altitude versus horsepower. So when you're going for 5,000, 10,000 feet altitude, 15,000, 20,000 feet altitude, you can see that horsepower. So for this, it will be like around 155 to 156 bhp. That will be for mainly for the aircraft when it's flying around 16 to 17,000 feet altitude. And we can look here around 200 horsepower. And it is the mainly the aircraft which are doing like LYCOM 10, 360. And we have a turbocharger aircraft. These are all the different types of aircraft and with their horsepower and power variation with the altitude. Understood. So therefore, you can see here, you can call the T by W takeoff, and this is called HP by W takeoff. It means that it is for thrust. This is mainly for the jet-based aircraft, and HP by W it's for mainly for it is for propeller-based aircraft. That is V cruise by 550 eta p, 1 by L by D cruise, and W cruise by W takeoff, and HP that is called horsepower during the takeoff, and we have a horsepower during the cruise. So this is called power loading, we will call it, during the takeoff condition, and the thrust to weight ratio during the takeoff. This is for jet based aircraft, and this is for propeller based aircraft. Mainly we have to understand how we are going to differentiate between the propeller as well as with the jet based aircraft. And also you can see here we have afterburning. Afterburners are mainly used during the takeoff to get the maximum thrust. To the maximum thrust after the when you call exhaust, we are keeping up this afterburners. It gives the extra thrust to the aircraft during the takeoff. It will helps us to and also avoids the extra engine fitting to the aircraft. So therefore, to get extra thrust during the takeoff, so therefore afterburners will be used. Clear? And we can look here, and also where typically the propeller efficiency is taken as 0.8. And now we are going to speak about wing loading. What is this wing loading? Wing loading is nothing but what? Wing loading is the weight of the aircraft divided by the area of the reference, which is not exposed. Means which is not exposed to air. That is called wing. That is as the wing loading we will call. That is called the area of the reference we will call. As with the thrust to weight ratio, the term wing loading is normally refers to the takeoff wing loading, but can also refer to the combat in the other flight conditions. Because whenever in the combat, what happens, there will be a combat maneuvering will be there, and we can look into it, we can say dog fightings will be there. And when you look here, so this wing loading is also mainly for other flight conditions. It's for other flight conditions. And we can look here, like a wing loading normally refers to the takeoff wing loading, but can also be referred to the combat and other flight conditions. Other flight conditions. And wing loading has a strong effect upon the sized aircrafts. Wing loading has strong effect upon the sized takeoff gross weight. If the wing loading is reduced, the wing is larger. It means that, so wing loading is reduced means larger the wing, there will be a, that is, we have a wing loading will be reduced. So therefore, if it is a smaller the wing loading will be higher, because when you look into it, the force which is acting per unit area will be higher, because we know that already pressure is force per unit area. Correct? If the unit area is reducing, force will be higher. So therefore, that is the wing loading, how it will be. So smaller the wing, there will be a higher the wing loading, larger the wing, lesser the wing loading. You have to understand the concept just in this. And also the T by W and W by S are taken considerations. They are interconnected. Okay. And when you look here, to estimate the wing loading required various performance conditions to ensure that wing provides the enough lift in all circumstances, the designer should select the lowest of the estimated wing loadings. However, it is unreasonably low wing loading value is driven by only one of these performance conditions. The designer should consider another way to meet the condition. So here we, when you look here, The stall speed of the aircraft is directly determined by the wing loading. So when always we speak about stall. What is the stall? At the higher angle of attack, there will be a maximum lift. Once it crosses, what happens? That the aircraft loses its control. It means that here, the stall speed of an aircraft is directly determined by the wing loading and the maximum lift coefficient. Stall speed is a major contributor of flying safety. Means if it is near the stall when the aircraft is flying, the pilot should make sure that the aircraft should not lose its control. If it loses its control, it will come and crash. So therefore, it's a lot of so when you are flying, the handling qualities during the near the flight. So therefore, always pilot will look the handling qualities, how the aircraft is, the handling qualities, how much it is good or bad. So we'll check that according to the ratings will be given, and we'll discuss about it. It's called Cooper-Hopper scalings. We'll discuss about it. And you can see the failure to maintain the flying speed. As the approach speed, which is the most important factor that landing distance and also contributes to post-touchdown accident, is defined by the stall speed. Means before touching it. So because what happens? So during the landing, easily when you come and land, everything will be there. Therefore, we have a V-stall during the landing will be around 1.3 V-stall will be taken up during the landing. So but what is happening here post-touchdown, when it reaches to the maximum, now lift and drag will be higher at that time, it may come and there may be leads to accident also. So therefore, we have to be very careful in the stall region. And also it mainly depends upon the wing loading. And also civil and military design specification establish the maximum allowable stall speeds for various class of aircraft. We have FAR 23, that is Federal Aviation Requirements 23, certified aircraft under 12,500, means according to the takeoff gross weight. This is called takeoff gross weight. It is 12,500 lb. Under the 12,500 lb, which are all aircrafts are designed, they're all comes under Federal Aviation Aircraft. That is called requirement. That is FAR 23 certified aircrafts. If they're going for FAR 27, they're more than 12,500. It's according to that aircraft we are segregating according to the Federal Aviation requirements. It is one of the standard body which certifies the aircraft. Okay. And while not stated in any design specifications, a stall speed of about 15 knots would be considered in the upper limit for the civil trainer and other aircraft to be operated by a low-term pilots. And you can see here, at a 5,000 feet altitude, hot day, value around 0.00118 to ensure that airplanes can flown into Geneva during the summer. So we can, when you look here, W is equal to L, that is lift is equal to weight. And Q stall, it is called stall dynamic pressure, and S is surface area, CL max is the maximum lift coefficient, that is minus half rho V square S into CL. So W by S is given by what? Half rho V square S into CL. The half rho V square CL max, that is V is called velocity during the, it's the stall velocity. CL max is the coefficient of lift. Understood. So the remaining unknown maximum lift coefficient can be very difficult to estimate. The values range from 1.2 to 1.5 for a plain wing with no flaps, such as 5 for a wing with a larger flaps immersed in the prop wash or jet wash. And so therefore, the maximum lift coefficient, the aircraft designed for short takeoff landing, that's called STOL, the maximum lift coefficient for aircraft designed for short takeoff. Means how much ever we are reducing the takeoff distance, that is called short takeoff. How much we are reducing the takeoff distance, that is called the, according to that, the wing loading is also the parameter of wing loading. It's typically about 3. It's typically about 3. And for regular transport aircraft, the flaps and slats, and also we have a improve the airflow, the maximum lift coefficient will be around 2.4. Clear? And we can look here. And maximum lift coefficients, the wings too of moderate aspect ratio, triple slotted flap, double slotted flap, double slotted flap, and Fowler flap, slotted flap, flame flap, low flap, no flap. These are all the flaps. Already you know that they are the high lifting devices. So therefore it will be, it plays a very important role in the generation of the lift. So they can see a CL max is equal to 0.9. CL max, already you know that small L determines for the airfoil. As S flapped, that is the area of the flapped flapping surface, and S reference, and CL unflapped condition, there is no flaps clear according to that. And you look here, and the takeoff distance, when you look at the takeoff distance is number of different values are referred as a takeoff distance. The ground roll is the actual distance traveled before the wheels, means whenever the aircraft will roll, or when it rolls, when it leaves the ground before leaving that is the distance, total distance before leaving the wheel, leaving the ground, that is called takeoff distance. We'll call it, it's called what? Takeoff distance. And the second one is called liftoff speed. Also, we'll call it 1.1 times of the stall speed. Please make the note of it here. During the takeoff, that will be 1.1 times of the V stall. 1.1 times of the V stall. 1.1 V stall. Yeah. And obstacle clearance distance is a distance required for a brake release until the aircraft has reached some specified altitude. This is called obstacle clearance. Unless or until some obstacle clearance, it is climbing at the rate where it is without any, it should not reach to the some specified altitude where the clearance of the obstacle will be there. And this usually around 15 feet for a military and small aircraft and 35 feet for a commercial aircrafts. Okay. And we speak about a balanced field length. These are all things we are speaking about runway. Okay. The one is takeoff distance. Another one is the obstacle clearance distance. And next is balanced field length. Is the length of the field required for a safety in the event of an engine failure at the worst possible time in a multi-engine aircraft? It means that once it crosses the balanced field length, we cannot cancel the takeoff. So therefore, when you are performing the takeoff, what happens? The engine should brake, or we are applying the brakes. If it crosses the balanced field length, we cannot have a control over the aircraft. So we have to take off. So therefore, if it is inside the balanced field length, I can... if any engine failures or any emergency condition, I can cancel the takeoff. Okay. So therefore it is called balanced field length, we will call. And when the aircraft has just begun its ground roll, the pilot would have no trouble stopping its safety safely in one engine, way to fail. As the speed increases, more distance would be required to stop after the engine failure. Clear? So if the aircraft is nearly the liftoff speed and an engine fails, the pilot would be unable to stop safely. Instead, would continue the takeoff on the remaining engine. So if during the takeoff, if any engine failure occurs, so if it is under the balanced field lens, then I can cancel the takeoff. If it is already crossed the, it is in the maximum speed as well as it is in the during the takeoff, it is in the already liftoff speed. So we cannot, and we have to take off and with the remaining engines. Clear? So that is the thing. So you should be very careful in this. And this is called in the FAR, they're called as the FAR takeoff field length, we'll call. And FAR 25 aircraft have 35 feet of obstacle clearance, and military aircraft will be having around 50 feet obstacle clearance. Clear? And both wing loading and we can look here for FAR 35 feet for a balanced width, and takeoff parameter, we will call, that is called takeoff parameter is divided by the product of density, that is called sigma, it's a density ratio. And we have a simply air density is rho, and the takeoff altitude is divided by the sea level, around 0.00238 slugs per cubic feet. And takeoff lift coefficient, or actual lift coefficient at takeoff, not the maximum lift coefficient at takeoff conditions, used for stall calculations. So therefore, here we can look here for a propeller based aircrafts, mainly W by S is equal to takeoff parameter into sigma into CL. This is called, you can see, takeoff parameter HP by W. Jet is for wing loading, takeoff parameter, it is T by W. So only the two parameters are changing here. One is power loading as well as thrust to weight ratio. So here wing loading and thrust to weight ratio, wing loading as well as power loading, they are interconnected. Okay, they are interconnected. So therefore, one thing you have to remember here, the first one is called as, that is a total distance, which is called as balanced field length. Once it crosses the balanced field length, we cannot cancel the takeoff. Clear? So total distance before the aircraft leaves the ground, that is called total, it is called, that is called FAR balanced field length, we'll call. It is called FAR balanced field length. You have to understand here. So according to the Federal Aviation Requirements, we have 23, 25, part 25, part 23, we'll discuss. Okay. So these are the different type of takeoff conditions. One is catapult type of takeoff. What is this catapult type of takeoff? Catapult is nothing but, you know, catapult, when you push the stone and we'll throw it, right? We'll push it and we'll leave it. So it's the same way what happens in the Navy base. We don't have a larger runways. At that time, what we will do, we'll push the aircraft with some velocity or some force and we'll leave it. At that time, it takes up the necessary force and it will take off. So that's called as such type of takeoff is called as a catapult takeoff. This catapult takeoff mainly is used in the naval based aircrafts. Clear? So therefore, W by S landing, that is half rho V end to the V. Understood? And we can look into CL max of takeoff 1.21. That is called wind over deck, we will call. This is called wind over deck velocity. Means in the deck, what should be the velocity of the wind to stop that? So therefore, it is called V end, V wind, like a wind over deck. It's called as a wind over deck. Clear? So we look here, and FAR 25 aircraft, the thrust reversers, and FAR 25 aircraft have an additional requirement for a 2/3 distance increase. The thrust reversers used for most FAR 25 aircraft shorten the landing distance by about same amount. So this is called landing distance. So landing distance is nothing but a what? So it is the distance where we can land. So when you are leaving the aircraft, it's called a takeoff distance. During the landing, what the distance we are covering, that is called landing distance. So is also a parameter of wing loading, we can like, and takeoff parameter 1 by CL max into SEA. Okay, SEA is 1000 for airplane type or on 3-degree glide scope. So when it is gliding without the power, that's called 3-degree glide scope, and 600 general aviation A type, that is power off approach. This it is called short takeoff and landing, that is called 7-degree glide scope. Okay, glide slope. And we look here, and arrested landing, aircraft which land on Navy aircraft carriers are stopped by cable and brake arrangement. Because I told you, the arrested landing during the takeoff, it's called catapult takeoff. Here, arrested landing, when it is coming and landing also, it requires a larger distance to landing distance. So two, we don't have a sufficient land or sufficient the area to land the aircraft. So therefore, we are doing a that is called arrested landing, that is called cable and brake arrangement, that is called arresting gear, we'll call it. It's arresting gear method, that's called arrested landing gear, landing method. Okay, so we have a maximum prop range and wing loading during cruise. Understood? These are the different type of parameters. We'll discuss clearly about it. Just to understand now what all the things are there and how the wing loading and T by W plays a very important role here. And wing loading for loiter, and you can see this is called instantaneous turn rates, and we have a G turns, and we have a 9G, 6G, 7G. We have a different type of turns, what we are speaking for different type of aircrafts. Okay, see here, maximum jet loiter. Loiter is nothing but a what? Endurance. Endurance is nothing but a what? Is the total time of the aircraft which stays in the air. And maximum jet loiter is a propeller loiter. Okay, that is for pi AE CD naught, 3 pi AE CD naught. This is for propeller based, this is for jet based. You can see the root 3 times of it. Okay, root 3 times of it. It's around 1.7, it will come. And we have instantaneous turn rate. So Xi is nothing but a what? Instantaneous turn rate for dog fightings. And we have mainly maneuvering military based military aircrafts. When you are going, you can see that in air shows and other things, we have a combating, dog fighting. We can do the different type of stunts by the aircraft. That's called as a, they are all done by the such type of a G turn that plays a very important role here, wing loading. Clear? And also we can see that T by W and L by D. So if the speed is maintained, the thrust must equal to the drag and the lift must equal to the weight times the load factor. So we can write it as T by W and into L by D. So therefore, we can look here, the turn load factor is maximized by maximizing the thrust to weight and L by D. The highest L by D occurs at the induced drag equals the, so therefore CDI is equal to CD naught. Then it becomes the L by D will be the highest. Lift to drag ratio will be highest. When the lift to drag will be highest, when the CDI, that is induced drag, is equal to the parasite drag. Clear? And here we can see T by W. And we have maximum ceiling. We have a, we can, this one is very important. When you look here, maximum ceiling, where the, we can, that 100 feet per minute means the frequently the small residual climb capability, that the climb of the aircraft should be 100 feet per minute. So it, that is the maximum ceiling where we cannot fly above that, the service ceiling, maximum ceiling. Once if you cross the maximum ceiling, where the structural deformation of the aircraft may occur. So therefore, that is called maximum ceiling, is a ceiling where the aircraft, if it flies above that ceiling, aircraft will structurally get deformed. So therefore, the maximum 100 feet per minute, and we have a 500 feet per minute. It depends upon the military as well as the civil based aircraft. Yeah. So, and these are the, and also we can see a low wing loading is always increase the aircraft lift and weight and cost. So therefore, if you are low, the wing loading will always increase the aircraft weight and cost. It's very low wing loading is driven by only one requirement, a change in the design assumptions. So therefore, if it's a larger the wing, the larger the weight will be there, and also lesser the wing loading will be there. And we can have a smaller engines, and the lift will be, lifting surface is increasing at the time, small engines are required. So it's a lot of things are there. So therefore, we have to understand here, that is T by W and W by S are interrelated, and also they affect on the performance of the aircraft, that is like a range, endurance and rate of climb, instantaneous turn rate. These are all are the performance of the aircraft. So therefore, when the best compromise for the wing loading has been selected, the thrust to weight ratio should be rechecked to ensure that all requirements are still met. These equations in the last section, which is T by W, should be recalculated with a selected W by S. Means W by S and T by W should be calculated hand in hand, not in a separately, independently. They are dependent. Why? Because the weight parameter is there in the both the things. So therefore, only then can next step of the design, initial sizing, be initiated. Once it done, then only I can go for the initial sizing. Clear? So if you have any doubts, please let me know.